Hey, I'm Chris, and welcome back. So, whenever I send out packages for my Etsy shop, I like to include a little extra thing in them, like a business card or something. And I've got these kind of, I don't know, plain ones I got from a printing shop. Got my logo on them and my name and website on the back. That's fine, but I don't know, they're kind of impersonal, kind of bland, so I don't know, they don't really do the job. I also have these handmade ones, which I made myself, and I actually really like them. They're a cyanotype or blueprint on one side, and they're letterpress printed on the other. But the problem with them is they're not very, like, readable. Also, they take a really long time to make. So I thought I'd make some simpler ones, just using letterpress printing, and show you my process for making the 3D printed letterpress printing plates I use. A little aside for those who may not know how letterpress printing works. It's basically just really fancy stamping. It's the kind of printing you think of when you think of old-timey printing presses and stuff. You got some kind of stampy bit like this, usually made of lead, and you'd assemble a bunch of those into a printing plate to make text. Then you would cover them in ink, and you press them onto paper to make, I don't know, Bibles or something. These days, there's a bit of a resurgence in this technique because, I don't know, it's kind of cool, I guess. So let's do this. Let's upset some people in the Hackaday comments by creating an inferior version of a time-honored technique using modern and accessible tools. So, of course, we're going to start this out in the only logical place to design a business card, a PCB layout tool. Okay, maybe don't do this if you want to actually replicate this, but I wanted to do a two-sided design that was kind of PCB inspired, so this didn't actually seem like that bad of a choice at the time. I started out with some text at the top, making sure to set the thickness of the stroke to a multiple of my 3D printer nozzle diameter, in this case, 0.4 millimeter. The fact that you can set this directly in a PCB layout tool is actually really handy. Afterwards, if we just take a look at the front layers here, I put down a dip 8 footprint, added some text to it, and added some traces and vias that will connect to the design on the back. I also added this double-sided card edge connector because, I don't know, I felt that looked kind of neat. If we take a look at the back, you can see the reverse of the edge connector and the traces that connect to the heart on the backside. And if we go into the 3D viewer here, you can turn off all the stuff we don't want to see, and you can actually get a pretty decent preview of what the card is going to look like in the end. Of course, the colors are going to be different. I then exported this design as an SVG and spent way too long cleaning it up in Inkscape afterwards. Because, well, turns out maybe a PCB layout tool is not the best for designing business cards. After a whole bunch of cleanup, I ended up with this, a clean SVG file with three layers, one for the front, one for the back, and one for the color fill inside the heart on the back, because I decided to actually go multicolor for this one. Each of those layers would have its own printing plate, so next I saved out each of those layers as a separate SVG file. If you were a somewhat sane person, you would probably just build your design in Inkscape to start with, or really any other vector graphics program, and save yourself all this hassle. If you want to do this yourself, it's important to make sure everything you have here is converted into filled paths. The program you're using in the next step doesn't really handle text and outlines well, so make sure to ungroup everything and then go to Path, Object to Path, and then Path, Stroke to Path to convert everything into filled paths. Afterwards, just save each layer as a separate SVG file. Now, all we need to do is to convert these SVGs into printing plates. To cut down on the manual work, I wrote a small script in OpenSCAD, which takes the SVG file, and after telling it the width and height of the file, it generates the printing plate for you. It even adds the little alignment and crop marks, which makes double-sided and multicolor printing a little easier, and tells you where to cut it out later. Also, instead of just a straight extrude of the SVG file, it thickens up the base of the printing parts a little, to make them more sturdy and less likely to break off or, you know, get crushed during printing. And last but not least, the slicing. You can slice this probably in any kind of slicer you want, but I'm using Proteus Slicer. I did some experiments with printing them at different layer heights, but that doesn't really make a big difference. So in the end, I settled on 0.15 millimeters, since that seemed to work fine. One thing that's important to make sure is to set the extrusion width to the smallest line width you want to print. So even if your nozzle is like 0.4 millimeter, it might be set a little bit higher by default in your slicer. So in my case, I just wanted to lower it to 0.4 millimeters since that was the width of the smallest line I used in my design. Another thing you can experiment with is the top infill pattern. This will sometimes show up in your print in solid areas as a slight pattern, so you can choose something that looks cool here, like the Hilbert curve. You can also try out ironing, I guess. I've never really tried that, but maybe it's good, maybe not. Give it a try if you want to do this. At this point, you can check that your generated G-code looks fine and captures all the small details, and send it off to your printer. The cool thing is that due to them being super thin, they print really fast. The surface part is really the base plate. Putting down the actual printing parts on top goes really quick. Of course, if you had a resin printer, you could make a much higher resolution printing plate. It'd probably be high res enough to do some pretty small text and maybe even half toning. Let's talk about printing presses. I got this one for around 100 euros, I think, and it's nice, but you don't really need one. As long as you have a way to press the plate firmly onto the paper, you can really do whatever you want. Like in lino cut printing, you could use the back of a spoon, or maybe a rolling pin, or two pieces of wood and a clamp, or just like, you know, do it by hand. But, you know, I saw this one at the store and I just knew. Was the one for me? That's so stupid. So, I start off by taping the printing plate down to a flat surface and giving it a light sanding. Just enough to knock down any small inconsistencies of the top layer, so it prints nice and smooth. Now, for inking up your plates, you can use a whole bunch of different things, like a proper fancy printing ink and a roller, but I just chose to be lazy and use an ink pad you'd normally use for stamps. It's a lot less of a mess, and in my experience, for small things, it works just as well. Afterwards, I just put some paper onto the plate. This happens to be a watercolor paper. Something a little thicker usually works better. I put some padding on top of that and crank it through the printing press. Et voila, first side done. When putting on the paper, make sure it doesn't slide around, so you don't smudge it with ink. Or don't. They still look nice when they're a little rough around the edges. It also usually takes me a few tries to get the pressure right. If there isn't enough pressure, the print will look kind of faded and incomplete, and if you press too hard, you'll end up crushing the paper, or even worse, the printing plate. After I'm done with the first side, I slice off the edges of the registration marks. This makes it easier to align the paper with the next plate for printing the backside. I then tape down the next plate, ink it up, and keep going with the back, carefully lining up the registration marks and repeat the same process. One thing you'll notice here is that I taped the plate at a bit of an angle. That makes it much easier to get through the press when there's kind of a single bump that's parallel to the roller, like the edge connector design at the top here. Afterwards, I just repeat the same thing for the last plate, this time with the heart. And I inked it up with a red ink pad. Once all the cards have been printed, I used the crop marks to cut out each card using an X-Acto blade and a ruler. And we're done! Yay! So these turned out pretty cool, I think. They're a little, rustic, sure, but at least that way people will know I made them by hand. I did kind of screw up the alignment of the color fill on the heart on most of them, but I don't know, I think it still looks neat. Also, this technique is really quick and easy, so you can make a whole bunch of these weird cards in a day. So this one, for example, just says yep on it, which is very important because I'm total furry trash, I guess. But it also shows you how you can use the different top infill patterns to get different textures. So this one uses the Hilbert curve for this kind of zigzag pattern in the filled parts. This one looks like it's vaguely 80s, maybe? I don't know. Not like American Psycho, more like synth pop or new wave. And this one's just a straight up barcode. I don't know, commentary on the human condition or something. I don't know, barcodes just look kind of cool, I think. Of course, you're not limited to using this on paper. You can use the same technique to print onto stuff like this vegan leather, for example, for this wallet that I made. You could also use real leather, probably, if that's what you're into. So, yeah, I hope you found this interesting. I put a link to the OpenSCAD script into the description below if you want to try this for yourself. And I guess I'll see you next time. Bye!